Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's a real pleasure to be here to talk to you. And apologies in advance, because I'm going to bring down the tone of the discussion, in fact, moving from the academic town hall world, in fact, into what do you do to deliver infrastructure in a hard way. The example I'm going to talk to you about, as mentioned, is in Iraq, so I should be saying salam alaikum. We, in fact, want to talk to you, though, about what's it like to deliver infrastructure in an in-between scenario in that spectrum of municipal planning, the post-conflict world. How do you put back together a city which, in fact, has suffered from some of the legacies of conflict and also neglect and degradation? So, in Iraq, we would say, lab al khair, welcome to my table. Let me share it with you. Okay. Project I want to talk to you about is a water project, but if I set that in context, for the last 12 years, Pell Frischmann have been working in Iraq, and we have, over that period, been involved in a succession of different projects which mirror the progression from a planning standpoint of the evolution of a post-conflict world. In 2003, we arrived in the country, and for 3 years, we spent our time working on law and order and justice projects. In 2007, we were engaged to produce a 30-year master plan for the city of Kirkuk. Those of you from the United Kingdom, the best way of describing Kirkuk is that it's the Iraqi version of Belfast during the problems, in fact. It's a focal point for ethnic tension, in fact, and the master plan was less to do about infrastructure planning and more to do about how do we blend a city together to accommodate the future ethnic tensions that were going to come out of that. After that, we moved into the regime of moving away from donor-funded projects into local projects commissioned by the Iraqi government directly. We're currently doing 3 transport master plans for the city of Hilla, Babylon, for those of you that don't know, Najaf, and Basra. So we've covered the entire spectrum of occupation, exit to the coalition, and now working for the Iraqi government. The project I want to talk about very briefly, which illustrates a segment of that type of work in midstream, is the water project for Midwestern Iraq. So top left-hand corner, from a cultural history standpoint, it is predominantly a Sunni area. It's the minority population in Iraq. It is the area that the Ba'athist culture and Saddam Hussein came from. And so an area which, after, in fact, the fighting in 2003, required particular sensitivity and handling. A chronic shortage of water leading to water rationing, a lack of continuous supply due to a lack of electricity, and improvements in water quality were absolutely essential. And those were the key ingredients for the project that we were asked to undertake. In the 3 cities of Haditha, which is in Al Anbar, the province of Al Anbar, some of you will have recently read about or heard about the Haditha Dam, very prominent in the news. It's the Al Anbar area. Secondly, Beji, the oil refinery area in Saladin. And lastly, an area called Mosul, which also has been very much in the news. Now, the critical issues about the sites chosen by the Iraqi government here is that, once again, they represent not only an area of the minority ethnic groupings within the Republic of Iraq, but they also represent individually distinct ethnic groupings within those areas. The Mosul population is predominantly Christian. The area around Beji is very much tied to Crete and the Ba'athist. And the Al Anbar area is a very independent, traditional area. The project was funded by JICA with respect to IFC. In fact, we also do work for IFC. But the Japanese International Cooperative Agency funded on a soft loan the construction of these facilities with the primary objectives of economic growth, economic infrastructure, and livelihood for the people. Basic problems we encountered in terms of undertaking the work initially were a lack of clear development policy and planning, staff skill shortages, outdated infrastructure and quality control was non-existent. This is the type of product that we produce. This is a design for a new water treatment works alongside the refurbishment of existing water treatment. These are the three locations that I mentioned we're working in. That's 1.2 million people in 2037 as a forecast population. That will represent 5% of the total population of Iraq and 12% to the land mass that we'll be servicing with that. So the opportunities were to standardize, to create common elements, and to also familiarize ourselves with the equipment so that we could create a legacy for use by locals. Constraints, the geology, the geography, the capacity, and the water quality that we've mentioned earlier. The commercial viability of this project is a legacy issue which the Iraqi government is yet to grasp. It's a common problem with water supply throughout the Third World. Water is free at the moment. How do you make it self-sustaining? And a revenue generation program is a key element for producing that. What are the lessons that we learned, in fact, in terms of working there? First of all, that to be successful, a understanding of how do you blend inward importation of expertise with local customs. Iraq is a well-established tradition, very high-quality engineering, very high-quality education standards, but a very out-of-date municipal infrastructure. Basically, a time warp, 35, 40 years, of a Stalinist-type environment where progress was very limited. Secondly, what could we do, in fact, in terms of embedding what we were doing? Knowledge transfer, 75% of all of our work in country is done by local people, and there's a total integration to what we're doing there. I think that gives you a very quick flavor of what a water project looks like in a post-conflict environment. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thanks. Maybe if there's a couple of questions. I mean, perhaps I could just ask you, Ankal. I mean, first of all, just actually on the physical design, anything that was particularly distinctive and characteristic compared with water treatment facilities elsewhere in the world?
Yes, I think that the primary lesson there is very much one of looking towards sustainability, keeping it simple, keeping it, in fact, sustainable in terms of future operation. Some of the interesting wrinkles, though, that we hadn't anticipated, obviously importing modern technology, we have assumptions from the West that low-cost operation is a critical issue. In fact, it was exactly the opposite there. One of the great fears that the Iraqi government had was that we were going to reduce the number of jobs from the operation. So part of the brief was actually to make the operation labor-intensive to ensure future employment.
And actually maybe then touching less on the physical and more on the human aspects of it. So local employment, was there a lot of thought to, you know, ethnic composition and other contexts, political affiliations and so on in employment and the ways in which you worked and the ways you were thinking about staffing longer term?
Absolutely every aspect had a local flavour and embedding. From the day we arrived in the country to ensure security and safety, liaising with local people, making sure that we provided as much employment to create those working relationships, but then also making sure that the underlying principles of the design and the nature of the service that we were providing was clearly demonstrably balanced for the whole of the community to make sure that we didn't have the, well, why are they getting this and why aren't we getting some of the same?
Mm-hmm. And ongoing, what are the security situations?
Well, it's interesting because I started out giving you that path of liberation or occupation, depending upon your standpoint of what happened in Iraq, through to post-coalition and self-governance. But of course, they've taken a step back, and these areas are currently occupied by ISIS. And now this project has been reclassified as a post-liberation project. In fact, it's on the hit list for when, in fact, ISIS are removed from Iraq, then it will be, construction will start on it.
Okay. Anybody got any questions in the audience? Can I see anything? No, don't think so. So shout out. Yes, please, there's one here. Is there a microphone? Just coming.
Thank you very much, Carl. My name is Time Wejamamere. I work at WaterAid, based in London. I kind of want to look at what you've said compared to what we've heard all day. So this brings us to the reality of some countries that we haven't really featured today, where a government tells you to design a project to be labor intensive. And some persons may think that that's not smart, or that's not transformational. So the context of different countries or different cities determine actually the solutions that should be applied from what you've said so far. I was thinking about the last session, the last panel we just had before we went on to lunch. And I did want to see or ask the question to that panel or for us to just think about, really. When we talk about aspirations and designs and transformed communities, whose idea is a transformed community? Whose vision are we trying to emulate? Are we looking for, like the story goes, the gentleman who goes on holiday and visits the local community where he finds a fisherman who lives in a hut, and ask the fisherman, why don't you move to the city and have a better life? And the fisherman says, oh, why did you come here? Oh, I've come for an holiday. Okay, well, I'm living your dream in my local community. And so we need to be careful when we begin to talk about regeneration and transformation and things like that. We need to find out how effective are we delivering basic services and how flexible are the concepts that govern and will sustain those basic services. I think some of the mayors and the chaps who run the cities where we work at WaterAid, we work in over 26 countries, are faced with this idea of trying to emulate Europe and America and trying to build infrastructure and cities that look exactly like Europe. And that's probably not what these countries need. And so I think our conversation should begin to think perhaps to stratify the markets we are referring to, and what's applicable in one market or context may not be applicable in the other market. I don't know what your views are on this.
I couldn't agree with you more, and certainly, personally, I'm very alive to that simply because in a previous life I was actually the director of planning and transportation for Westminster City Council, so where you're sitting at the moment. So going from that world of townscape planning for a national seat of government, a business center, and also the cultural center of a European capital, to what is happening in the Middle East is worlds apart. And I think that if, in fact, a consultant or an aid agency or a commercial organization, whether it's banks lending for investment in those areas, approaches with what I think in plain English might be described as a colonial professional pedestal in terms of how they see services being delivered, then I think you do run the risk of, in fact, producing a product which isn't going to be used, which is disjointed. And I'm afraid that that part of the world is littered with a number of power stations, for instance, that have been constructed, which don't have distribution networks to link them up. And so the absence of overall strategic planning, I think that tier of planning that we were talking about this morning in the London context or in a regional context is absolutely essential as a blueprint. But then when it comes to implementation, I think the blending of international expertise with local culture and finding local applications and local ownership for those products is absolutely essential.
Okay, I'm afraid we better move on to the next thing, but so do please thank Carl. And could I now ask Jem Nahum to come up on the stage? Thanks, Jem, who's a member of the executive committee at Hexagon, Katı, Atık.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Jem from Hexagon, Katı, Atık. We are a solid waste management company operating in Turkey. and we believe we have identified an innovative solution to the business of waste management. First of all, I'd like to start quoting an FT article from May 26th, which reads, "Cities have always been big business. Machines for creating..." Hold on, I forgot my slide. There you go. So cities have always been big business. Machines for creating money and culture. A means for people to gather and create a civilized, comfortable life. Now, as we heard many times today, such civilized, comfortable life does come with certain caveats and certain unwanted, unwelcome byproducts that needs to be dealt with. And urban municipal waste is one of these products. Now, waste management is actually a quite costly activity. And unfortunately, the value that can be generated out of waste management is not sufficient to cover the entire cost structure of the waste management activities. Hence, there needs to be some kind of a tipping fee or a social cost, in other words, in order to subsidize the cost of the waste management activities. Now, classical waste management businesses mostly rely on either recycling of packaging material or other raw material and being sold as commodities to the industry, or some kind of an energy generation from the organic fraction of the waste. Once the energy is generated, there remains an organic residue, which is called a digestate, which usually ends up being low-quality soil. And also the remaining fraction ends up being inert material that goes into the landfills. Now, as Hexagon, we have identified a certain way to make better use of the organic fraction of the waste stream after energy has been released and electricity produced. This digestate that remains, we actually mix it with agricultural waste and some type of organic animal manure in order to create an agriculture-grade compost, which is then turned into a fertilizer and then used in the agriculture industry. By doing this, we have been able to greatly enhance the value we have been able to extract from waste, and hence decrease the social cost and the tipping fees, and made our business model relies a lot less on tipping fees. The type of fertilizer we make is called an organo-mineral fertilizer because it's half organic content and half mineral content, which is the mineral plant nutrients that the plants need. Now, when you compare the fertilizer we make to the conventional mainstream fertilizers used in the industry, when you apply a fertilizer to the plant, if there's organic matter in the fertilizer, the plant can actually absorb a lot more of the minerals that you apply, and hence greatly increase the yields that you get from the crops. It's typical to see 15 to 20% yield increases when you use our fertilizer compared with regular conventional fertilizers. Because the plant can actually absorb a lot more of the nutrients, a lot less remains in the soil and a lot less causes soil pollution. Also, that means a lot less goes into the runaway waters to pollute our underwater water sources as well. Additionally, the organic fraction remains in the soil and hence causes a more fertile soil to be available for future fertilizer applications. Now, we produce our fertilizers in the form of either small pellets or granules, which each contains the same amount of chemical and organic composition. So, and the reason we make them in these forms is that they can be easily dispensed with existing agricultural machinery, and it can be used throughout the agriculture industry wherever regular conventional fertilizers are used. We've built a portfolio of close to 10 different fertilizer types, depending on the mineral chemical content we use in them. So to summarize, at Hexagon, we have been able to generate electricity from waste, recycle the packaging and other raw materials in order to produce raw materials for production of goods to be consumed in our cities. We've also been able to create a high-quality agriculture-grade compost, which we turn into a fertilizer, which is used in the agriculture industry to feed our cities. We currently have one operational plant in the Pamukova region of Turkey, which is 200 kilometers away from Istanbul. And we have three other projects in various stages of development in the western region of Turkey. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Cem. We don't have long, but so one of the criteria for these awards is commercial viability. Just tell us a little bit about what the economics of this are like.
As I've said, like usual common waste management projects rely heavily on tipping fees that are collected from municipalities in the form of payments depending on the amount of waste you collect and manage. Certain ones, especially the ones that deal with burning the waste, only rely on these tipping fees. But our model, actually 85% of our revenues come from the fertilizer we make and sell. So, the fertilizer in Turkey, the tipping fees are quite low. So usually there are not many private companies dealing with waste management because international companies have not been able to enter the Turkish market with such low tipping fees. But our model has been able to make this waste management business plan feasible throughout with the help of the fertilizer.
So even in this first plant that you cited, you actually come out net on top, as it were.
I mean, the technology that we used did not exist when we first started this. So a lot of R&D expense went into designing the process, and there was a lot of trial and error as well. But if you exclude the R&D work, yes, the first plant does become profitable at the moment.
And in theory would actually save the local authority money when you remove the tipping fees and other costs?
It saves the local authority money, the way actually these projects are bid for is that you bid on the percentage of profit that you pay back to the community, to the municipality. So the municipality ends up making money rather than spending for the waste management.
Right. And I don't know how best to quantify this, but just give us an idea, you know, of the total bulk, perhaps, then, of waste that's being produced. What percentage, if that's the right way to express it, would be transformed into your fertilizer products?
So let me say, we treat at our first plant, which is almost like a pilot-sized plant, we treat 100,000 tons of waste per year, and we produce 40,000 tons of fertilizer.
Great. Anybody in the hall got any questions? No. If not, do please thank Cem.
Thank you.
Okay, and so now we'll have a little presentation from Andrew Zolli, if Andrew's in the room somewhere. Yep, here he is. Andrew, come on up, please. Perhaps I'll go down to watch. So I should say Andrew from Planet Fellows.
Great. Hi, everybody. How are you? I just got off a plane from New York. I just want to take a moment. Can we just take a moment? Your municipalities are profiting from their waste stream. That is, I live in the, I hope you won't mind me saying, I come from New York City, which is the capital of bullshit. And I think the ability to subsidize our municipal budget in New York has just taken a giant leap forward in my listening to the last 5 minutes presentation. So that is really amazing. It's a great honor and pleasure to be here with all of you today. Because many of you don't know anything about me, I'll just say a couple of quick words of introduction. I'm Andrew Zolli. I'm a futures researcher. I study longer-term trends in emerging technology and demographics and societal, ecological, and other forces. Today, I help oversee a portfolio of extraordinary humanitarian, social, and developmental organizations at a breakthrough new aerospace and geospatial sensing company called Planet Labs that I'll tell you about at the end of this presentation. I want to give you a much broader contextual look and think together about resilience and how we build resilience in this age of really tremendous volatility. And so to do a little context setting right at the beginning of these works, and I also like to walk around, so I'm not going to stay back here. just to do a little bit of context setting, also it's like God's flashlight is shining down on you in judgment. It's not a pleasant place to be. So let's just take a moment and think about the context in which we are thinking about development, resilience, transformation. What's going on in the world now? And how does change happen? Well, so I think the first thing to say about it is that there isn't a single story. Because today, the scope and speed and scale of the challenges that we confront, and I mean it on a planetary scale, just if you think about us as a human civilization, an inclusive human family, really are bigger than most of our natural cognitive abilities. They sort of swamp our natural cognitive abilities. They're happening at scales that are much larger, much faster, or much slower. They happen in very different ways than we normally go about our daily lives. They happen, therefore, outside of the way that we think. But similarly, there's this extraordinary set of new tools that we now have at our disposal. Many of those are accelerating and emerging so quickly that they really happen outside of the day-to-day experience. They sort of happen at the edge of our everyday experience. And both of those things are happening at the same time. And it makes it a very confusing and volatile time. We have lots of reasons for despair, and we have extraordinary reason for optimism in seemingly almost equal measure some days. And just to illustrate what it means to sort of cognitively notice the change that's happening around us, I'd like us to start. I'm going to be speaking for about the next 25 minutes or so, and to start my remarks, what I thought I would do, I just want to show you something. I'm going to show you two, we're going to play a little game together, okay? I'm going to show you two images on this screen, and they're going to flash on the screen like this. They're going to go. Took me a long time to learn how to do that, by the way. And I promise you, there is one and only one difference between the two images. And what I'd like you to do is when you spot that difference, what I'd like you to do is gently raise your hand, not competitively block the person next to you. This is not like you're not competing with the people at your table. I just want to get a sense for how quickly we in the room see this change. So do you all understand that? There's one and only one change. Honor system, I want you to raise your hand when you see it. Are you ready? And go. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10, 11, 12, 13, I'm just going to get 15, 14, one more, 15. Okay. Now, just out of curiosity, how many people here saw no difference between those two? I'd like you to meet the honest cohort here at the Transformational Business Conference. I don't know what those other people were looking at. You never mess with a man with a clicker. It's dangerous. You can put your hands down. Now, for those of you who didn't see the difference, and that's most of us in this room, by the way, and I didn't see it the first time I was shown this, I'd like you to pay attention to this part of the image right there. And I'd like you to watch as the thing that holds airplanes in the sky disappears in front of your eyeballs over and over and over and over again. Now, I want to ask you a follow-up question, which is how many people here took an airplane to come to this conference? Please raise your hand. Ah. Okay, so a hint, when you go home, as you're going down the jet bridge, just look out and make sure that there is still one attached. Now, why is it that we miss this? Why is it that we didn't see it? And the vast majority of us don't see it, by the way, ever. We never see it. Well, it has to do with a couple of things. First of all, how many people here started by looking at the uniforms of the soldiers? How many people started by looking at the tail of the airplane? See how many hands go up? Do you know why we do that? Did you choose to do that? No. Your brain did that automatically because your brain looks for changes, particularly in places where it expects to see change, because we're used to looking at the tail fins of airplanes to figure out where they are, and also we're used to looking in places that are strongly tied to human beings. So we look at the uniforms of the soldiers. We don't look at the places we don't expect change to see. And most of the time, there's nobody telling you that something important has changed in the scene. A wonderful thinker about the future named Stuart Brand said something really aptly about this. He said, in our society, the fast-moving trends are the ones that get all the attention, but it's the slow-moving trends, it's the ones that are happening at speed and at scales that you don't normally see that have most of the power. And that creates a universe of densely interconnected, knotty, thorny, messy problems. Problems in which you solve your particular strand and you might make another part of the strand what we call the giant hairball. By the way, don't ever Google giant hairball. It cannot be unseen. But we live in this nested complex in which we feel the fierce urgency of action, but we see the dense interconnectivity of these problems. And our 21st century development challenge, which I think is why the resilience narrative has come to the fore, is really this. How do we enable, when we can't see the changes that are happening around us necessarily every day, how do we help people, communities, and systems recover, persist, or even thrive amid disruption, among inevitable disruption, among inevitable surprise? So that's what I want to talk about. Now, it's useful to take that question, the kind of resilience challenge, and break it into four pieces. What we see is sort of four things that resilient systems and resilient communities do. And the first one is they build lots of regenerative capacity. Much of the development work that we do and that we'll be celebrating here is about building that kind of capacity that builds upon itself, the sort of foundational platforms. In a community context, it might be indicated not just by the quality of the infrastructure, but by the quality of the trust, the social cohesion, the sense of community, belonging, social permission attached to the people who live in those communities. There's a second part of the story about building resilience in systems, which is about sensing emerging risk and how we instrument people, communities, and systems to listen for change. Now, not every change and not every disruption can be anticipated, but the very act of listening is itself a form of capacity building. How do we build the social structures for listening for change and acting upon it? That's a long-term struggle. Then there's responding to disruption. And the one thing I can tell you from having, I and a colleague wrote a book about resilience. We traveled around the world looking at resilient communities around the world. Every single resilient response was unique. It was largely a mixture of some stable platforms and a lot of improvisation. It was not bureaucratic. It was what we call ad hocratic. It was an adhocracy. So how do you encourage adhocracy in our response, creative reimagining? And then there's this last piece, which is about learning and transformation. When a system has shown itself to be vulnerable, when do we reinvest in strengthening it? And when do we decide that we want to eliminate our dependency upon it altogether and move to a new place? And here's the big punchline. A truly resilient community, person, system, family, by the way, your body, the cells in your body, your immune system, in fact, many of the systems that make you go, in all of those systems, all of these things are happening in varying degrees, depending on the context, all the time. There are both feed-forward and feed-backward loops. Building regenerative capacity and doing learning and transformation tend to be very slow processes. Listening for change and responding to disruption tend to be very fast. So there's a connection between moving fast and moving slow in a system. So what I would like to do now in the balance of our short time together this afternoon is talk to you about three ideas, three things that we see in looking out at the landscape of change that seem to be themes that are, they're not rules. They're more like heuristics. They're not governing principles, but they rhyme. You see them appear again and again. So I want to talk about three of those. And the last one, the first one I'm going to talk to you about is about the things we build. The second is about communities. The third one is about new technology. So first, about rethinking infrastructure. So 80% of humanity lives on a coast. Much of the infrastructure for urban places that were designed, if that infrastructure was built more than 50 years ago, like, for instance, I live in New York City, much of the infrastructure is buried. So if you live on a coast in an era of rising seas and you've put your infrastructure underground, you have a problem. And that problem isn't going to go away. So we certainly need, in the global context, in the development context, new forms of infrastructure. But it's not just emulating the kinds of infrastructure that we've built 20, 30, 40, 50 years ago. It has to be designed for the elastic and dynamic and volatile environment in which we live. Now, I'm going to use examples that come from sometimes from my own home country, but they are applicable, we think, around the world. So one of those is about using passive forms of infrastructure. When Manhattan was first visited by the Dutch, the island of Manhattan, it was ringed with oyster beds, and it was ringed with marshes. Those marshes played an incredibly important part in making Manhattan inhabitable because they absorbed the shocks and disruptions of storm surges and things like that. And so there's a movement now to restore that kind of natural form of what we think of as natural infrastructure. It's not building another higher wall, because if you build a 10-foot wall around a place, everything will be wonderful until you meet an 11-foot wave. And then things fall apart. So this is a process of beginning to think about how to accommodate rather than resist. And it begins by leveraging the engineering principles found in the natural world. Now, that's not the whole story, because there's also another form of much more dynamic infrastructure that's coming. And this uses two key principles of the 21st century. The first one is distribution and connectivity, innately distributed, innately connected forms of infrastructure that is more provisional in nature. And it's interesting that some of it has come from the world's aid organizations, developmental contexts, peacekeeping operations, who know how to rapidly build a bridge, how to rapidly build a building, how to put in place kind of rapid infrastructure. And this is hugely important in a disaster context. You know, I was talking to someone at the UN who said they did a study of the average length of a refugee experience at the tail end of the 1990s. At the tail end of the 1990s, the average refugee experience for an internally displaced person was 9 years from the time they were displaced. They've just redone it, and it's 20, which means that if you're pregnant on the day you are displaced, if you are a Syrian who's now living in a Jordanian community, your children will come to majority within the context of your displacement. And the boundary between rapid response and development has blurred almost to meaninglessness. So we have to begin to think about building infrastructure that can absorb those kinds of shocks and disruptions. And a big part of it is going to be about building small, cheap, failure-tolerant, highly redundant, highly networked forms of infrastructure. And you can start to see the beginnings of that with things like wireless mesh networking. Elon Musk, who gets a lot of credit for having built electric car companies, made it maybe a more important announcement that he's gotten into the battery business because he wants to be able to enable distributed microgrids to store all the energy from newly empowered photovoltaics that are getting better by the day so they can use the energy when it's not sunny. All of those kinds of themes are things we're going to see a lot more of. Okay, the second theme I want to talk to you about is about designing the principle that we use to describe it as with, not for. It actually came up in a very thoughtful question about whose agenda gets proposed and whose agendas get acted upon. One of my friends who is an activist, actually I'll tell you when I show you her picture. So in order to tell you this, I want to talk to you first about how communities are structured and how influence is structured. So we're going to play another little game together, okay? I want to show you a network of people. Now, because there's lots of people from different parts of the world in this room and different cultures and different perspectives, there's no names, there's no ages. This is in an organization. All the names have been taken out, replaced with numbers. The purple lines represent their connections to one another. And I want to start by asking you a really simple question, okay? If you wanted to tell everybody in this network something as quickly as possible, you wanted them all to know it as quickly as possible, and you could only talk to one person intuitively, who do you want to talk to? Just shout it out.
Four.
Any other guesses?
Eight.
Hold on. And I heard 10. 4, 8, and 10. Okay, so let me just take those three guesses, 4, 8, and 10. Four is a good guess, and about 80% of people guess number four, and the first time I was shown this, I guessed number four, because it's the, well, in the United States, we would call it the chatty Cathy node on the network, the person in your organization whose job you can't determine, but who knows everyone's personal business. Do you know what I'm talking about? You all have that person in your life? They know everybody, but you can't quite tell what they do. Okay. Then number eight is a good guess, because number eight is a bridge node. If it doesn't go to, if it doesn't get to eight, it's not going to one side or the other. And there's always a few people who guess number 10. Number 10 is the least common of the top three choices. It's the number three choice, but it's only 1 or 2%. And I think it reveals something fascinating about leadership, which is what? Find the most isolated human being in the chart. They must be the one in charge, right? Because you can't just let this alpha gorilla wander around the organizational zoo. They'd be given the thumbs up and thumbs down to the wrong thing. It would be chaos. So you have to hide them behind the executive vice president and the senior vice president and all those kinds of infrastructures. But the interesting thing about this is that most of us get it wrong. Because if you wanted to tell everybody in this organizational structure something as quickly as possible, you'd actually want to talk to number six or number seven, because they're the shortest distance to all the other nodes on the network. And it's not intuitive. It's not obvious. It's another disappearing aircraft engine. And yet, think about how much our development projects rise or fall on connecting with the right people and understanding the social architecture that surrounds them. I specifically think about work we were doing in New Orleans after Hurricane Katrina hit in the United States. You could walk down a street in the lower Ninth Ward and talk to this guy on your right. And in fact, what he's doing is he's rebuilding a house in which his mother and his wife perished. So think about the level of social commitment to place that is required to go back to the home in which your most cherished loved ones lost their lives and rebuild. And literally across the street, if that is on the right, you turn left. Oops, sorry. And you see what looks like open prairie. And what you can't see is that underneath all that greenery are slabs of concrete for houses that were never rebuilt. So what's the difference between that side of the street and this side of the street? What causes rebuilding and reconstitution? All of these neighborhoods were flooded with cash. They all had resources. There were NGOs aplenty. So why did you get this and not the other one? It had to do with this woman, Pam DeShields. She was the local, sort of what you'd think of as sort of like a neighborhood leader. We end up calling them translational leaders. Really good, effective, informal community leaders who are good at translating with the formal authorities to understand what the local communities needed, wanted. And also, she maintained the database, the phone tree of where everybody went in that diaspora that followed, and then called them all back. No development would have been possible without her. And she famously said to me, it was quite a moment, she said, if you're not at the table, you're probably on the menu. And that's how she saw the world. So she went right into all those tables and said, no, this is what you're going to do for us. So I think about that level of kind of sociological surround and how much our efforts really rise or fall on people that really aren't the client. They're not the investor. They're not the people providing the financing. they're the people providing the uptake. In fact, actually, more broadly, after Superstorm Sandy, which hit my community, we found that communities where people trusted each other, where there was a PAM to SHIELDS working, recovered twice as fast, having experienced the same level of disruption as communities where people didn't report trusting each other because there were no people who to glue them together. And in international development more broadly, I think we often suffer. It's not just a matter of figuring out who those people are so you can tell them what you want them to do. There's often this sort of implicit, it feels like a kind of tacit thermometer that runs underneath development, in which at one end of the spectrum, you have people who are rural, traditional, living in relational economies, who are hardly informal, mutualistic, who might be place-based, who are often problematized. And at the other end of the spectrum, you have urban, secular, market-driven, formally employed people, very migratory, who are seen as the solution space. And I think this is problematic for a couple reasons. I mean, first of all, it doesn't leave us who live at this end of the spectrum anywhere to go. Not only does it make this make a problem of people who may not see their lives as problem statements, but it also, if you happen to have lived at the other end of the terminus, there's no place to go. You have to give yourself some place to go, and much more importantly, recognize that we are going to live in a garden of many forking paths in which, if we do development really well in the 21st century, we're going to do it radically different from place to place. This cannot be about a homogenization and sort of a one-size-fits-all solution. Okay. Again, I can only talk about these sort of glancingly in the context of our conversation today. I'm going to be around, though. I'm really excited to talk to all of you. The last thing I want to talk to you about is about sense and sense-making. What I mean by sensing is using new technologies to allow us to peer into the world and to create the most robust context for action. So what do I mean by that? Well, now we're going to replay the exercise from before. I'm going to show you two images on a screen. There's really one difference between the two images. I want you to see if you can spot it, okay? This is a picture from the announcement of the voting on the investment, I suppose you call it, of Pope Benedict in 2005. Here's exactly the same shot of Pope Francis being elected in 2013. Can you see a difference? Okay? Let me know. As soon as you've spotted it, raise your hand. Okay? What was the difference? The difference was that between 2005 and 2013 and 2007, the iPhone happened. And it apparently happened to everybody, right, in a matter of just a few years. When you put those kinds of devices in the hands of humanity, really interesting things can happen, things that are not obvious. So for instance, the folks at Google who make the other half of all the devices that we use regularly have those devices check into whatever cell tower they're connected to, and the rate at which they move between cell towers turns out to be a really good proxy for the traffic on the roadways. Because if everybody's got one, you can get a pretty good sense for how things are moving along the road. Of course, people don't really want that. What they really want, and I think this is where we're going, is out of the age of big data. That's a picture of big data. Nobody wants to hang out with big data. Big data is big, boring, okay? But big indicators, that's, I think, where the story moves. It's not telling you a picture of everything. It's telling you a picture of what to do about everything. And you're starting to see municipalities really think about this in a different way. One of my favorite examples comes from this organization, the municipal government in Boston, that used another aspect of these devices, the fact that they all have accelerometers in them. You know, they're motion sensitive. So what they did is they built a little app that they ask the municipal waste workers and police officers to keep on in their cars. And as they're driving around, every time they hit a pothole, it sends a signal off. And if enough cars drove over a pothole, they automatically dispatch a truck to go fix the pothole. And they fixed thousands of potholes in a system that required zero reporting. In fact, some police officers figured this out and started driving over the potholes to encourage the algorithm to go out and fix them. Probably the most interesting one that you may have heard a lot about is this new taxi matching service called Uber. And I don't want to spend a lot of time talking about Uber. It gets a lot of press, but I want to mention a really interesting thing about Uber. A group of people, so you all know what this does. It allows you to hit a button on your phone and have a car come. It basically is a matching service for drivers and riders. But what's really interesting is that, again, in my city, people just did a study in which they discovered that it takes an ambulance, if you're having a heart attack, on average, 6 minutes to reach you. It takes an Uber, on average, an Uber driver, 2.4 minutes to reach you. And now the city of New York and Uber are discussing ways of putting the jump starter, what do you call those paddles? You know what I'm talking about? In the backs of all the Ubers. Because they're likely to be able to get there faster. Call 911 and then call Uber. One of them will get there quickly. So you begin to see the beginnings of new, entirely new service architectures. This is another one from a fantastic organization called Premise that has thousands and thousands of people who they pay small amounts of money to go out and take pictures, like to go to the store in a particular geography, like say in eastern Kenya, go to your market and take a picture of every kilo of bananas. Just take a picture of the price of bananas in your market. We'll pay you for the picture. Here's an example. We'll pay you for carrots. We're going to take thousands of pictures of carrots and how much they cost. Then we'll run algorithms over to tell us instantaneously what the price of a kilo of carrots really is in the market, which gives you profoundly more sensitive data, real-time changing data about food security, food scarcity, about changing market dynamics. So entirely new services that we haven't even thought about before are suddenly becoming available. And that leads me to Planet Labs, where I'm now going to wrap. So Planet Labs, a fascinating enterprise, started by three NASA engineers. And I will say, we are incredibly proud, enormously proud of the fact that IFC is an investor in Planet Labs. So I both want to, for full disclosure, but also tell you, not so much for disclosure purposes, but because we're totally thrilled. To understand what Planet Labs does, let me just say that it was started by three NASA engineers. And when you work at NASA, the way that NASA builds spacecraft is, you know, they take several billion dollars to build. They take a couple of decades from concept execution. They're as big as a school bus. So these three young engineers said, well, this is not the way that anything else happens in our lives. They went down to the local electronics shop. They bought an off-the-shelf Android phone. They went back to the lab because they're NASA scientists. They built a tiny little satellite around it and gave it to an astronaut who was headed to the International Space Station and asked her if she would throw it out the airlock to see how well your phone does in space. And it turns out your phone does great in space, totally amazing. And it has a camera and a computer and all these things. So they decided to build these very tiny little satellites. They're actually only about, they're 30 centimeters long and 10 centimeters squared. So they're quite small. They're like about the size of a loaf of bread. We refer to them as doves. And each one is a camera. And by the middle of next year, there'll be 150 of them. They've already done about 80 launches. So there'll be about 150 of these. And together, that entire system will take a complete picture of the surface of the Earth, not at a resolution that violates anybody's privacy, as you'll see in a second, much more lower resolution than that. But it'll capture everywhere in the world every day, which will allow you to see the kinds of changes, fine-grained changes, in how we manage our resources, how our cities are growing, how our crops are doing in the field, how we're doing with climate adaptation. Here's just one example to give you a sense for the kinds of things that are going. This is a picture of a city. This was the last satellite image of that city. Then the Planet Labs people did a Passover. The image is actually not all that terrific, but it turns out the algorithms can really handle, even in this case, fairly fast-moving, low-resolution image. And what I don't, it's a little hard to see given the lighting conditions in here, but can you see the little red stuff that appears? Everywhere that you see a red dot, something changed. Some piece of building got built. In fact, actually, what I'd really like you to look at is this piece right here. See this here? This, right? An entire bridge appeared that was not on the map. Right? There. And you can see that the algorithm actually detected it. So because while you can't tell that the aircraft engine disappeared and reappeared, the algorithm has no such biases. It just sees all that change.
It turns out only about half of the buildings that we discovered in this one flyover were properly zoned, and only about two-thirds of them were paying property taxes. Fascinating to a certain cohort of people. But it's not just about that. It's not just about watching our cities grow, planning our infrastructure. We discovered, because the satellites are going now, entire, not buildings, cities, entire communities that are not on the map in China, on any map, just sprouting up naturally like biological organisms. Here's the reservoir in Brazil. Again, this is the difference that you can see in a week when the reservoir goes down. So real-time sensing of these kinds of systems allows us to do entirely new, much more proactive forms of management. Here's just one more. This is sugarcane in Brazil. These are one day apart. Okay? So you can actually see them burning the sugarcane. That's interesting in its own right because it's an indicator of when things will actually be coming to harvest downstream. But it's also important to see, you can actually see the progress that the farmers are making in the fields, which has enormous implications for food security. And what's really coming in the end are, on the basis of all these kinds of data, entirely new forms of development opportunities. This one happens to be, this young farmer is, she is the first person to be paid under a wonderful distributed microinsurance scheme in rural Kenya called Kalima Salama. It's now been renamed. But the market for agricultural microinsurance for smallholders is only marginally tapped worldwide because it's very hard to get a sense for what's going on in the world. But when you've built a global sensor network, you can literally see change happening in the world all the time. We should be able to scale up some of these solutions, take the hard-won lessons of things that have been built on the ground and begin to bring them to an entirely new place. So my message to you is that there is no question our challenges are enormous, but it's also true that our tools are really going to be extraordinary. And when we put them together, no one's even thought, including us, about how to put them all together yet. We're still building them. But the way in which we do development, the speed, cadence, caliber, scale of development is going to begin to match the scale of the challenges and the scale of the tools, and that's really exciting. So thank you.
Thanks very much, Andrew. Yeah, when I worked in New York 25 years ago and it was still push-button fixed phones, they had a thing, 1-800-POTHOLE, I remember. Things have moved on a little bit since then, though. The automation is great. So we've got two or three more brief presentations before we head to our final session. So could I ask Patricia, if she's here, to come to the front, please? Yeah. If you could try and keep it to about 10 minutes, that would be great. Patricia. So Patricia Armendariz is the Chief Executive of Financiera Sustentable de México.
Good afternoon. I cannot be thankful enough for the opportunity of Financial Times and the IFC to share with you our project. For me, it's an example of how a private sector can give solutions to a public good. I'm going to talk about, in the case of Mexico, how we are dealing with financing a cleaner air for Mexico City. As we all know, Mexico City is one of the most polluted cities in the world, which is attempting against our own sustainability as human beings, 20 plus million people, and also the climate change in the whole world. The usual suspect, transportation, is the main aggressor. It accounts for more than 60% of total energy in gasoline and diesel, and accounts for 100% of carbon dioxide in the area. What doesn't help us also is that it's an expansive transformation system. The development, the urban development that the government has chosen, instead of having massive transportation systems like in London, for example, they have chosen second floors, and that contribute to even more increase in transportation as a main pollutant in area. During the last 20 years, we have experienced 70% increase in private transportation, going from 3 to 5 million vehicles in the city. Well, the government response, oddly enough, has been to restrict private transportation during the week for private vehicles, which has imposed a huge pressure on the public transportation systems in the area with very poor transportation infrastructure. The usual suspects have been, again, the base of the pyramid. Mexico City is a big heart where in the mornings people are being pumped into the city, which you see in the orange area, and in the afternoons and evenings they are being siphoned again into their poor areas where they all of these people live. So they are the usual sufferers of this pressure on the private sector transportation again. So there is a lack of public transportation to the base of the pyramid where people cannot have access to dignified transportation to their works every day. Basically, what we are having here is that 70% of public transportation vehicles need to be renewed, which means more or less just for this type of vehicles, 42,000 vehicles that need to be refinanced for better transportation systems, which accounts for more or less $1.4 billion of need to finance a new renewal of this transportation system. Even if finance was available, were available, which is not, unfortunately, people do not have enough money to renew their vehicles. So what we tried to do, it was basically to try to finance this in a sustainable way. First of all, we enhanced the payment capacity of the public transportation micro-entrepreneurs by only financing natural gas consumption vehicles, new natural gas consumption vehicles, which cost less than 50% the price of gasoline and diesel. Since they circulate every day, the government avoids the restrictions on circulation for natural gas vehicles, so they enhance even more their income. The base of the pyramid has better transportation systems. Most fundamentally, we have better air in the city, and we have all this in a financing model where we are producing zero non-performing loans to this in this model, with 40% return on equity to our investors. In the finance model that we had to do, we basically did it by foot. We went to the cooperatives where the transportation providers work, and we asked them what would work for them. And we envisaged a model where their flows would be increased, their cash flow would be increased, and their financing capacity could be also increased. Basically, what we could achieve with this is that by circulating more days, the gross income increased basically 35%. The fuel costs decreased by 60%. So their net income increased by 217%. So they had enough savings to pay for financing. And even after paying for financing, their available income increased by 63%. So it was a win-win-win-win situation for everybody. Most importantly, the base of the pyramid got better, more dignified, have been able to get more better and dignified transportation systems. And of course, a much cleaner air, because natural gas reduces 90% of total emissions in the city. Of course, we have huge challenges ahead. On the one hand, we need lots of money, lots of financing, very, very good returns, as I told you before, but massive financing is needed in order to sustain our project. We are being able to get more from the savings that these people themselves are creating, but institutional investors would be very much welcome to our project. And also, we need to increase the supply of natural gas in the city. We need 40 more gas stations in order to provide the increased demand for this new fuel in the city. And this, for this, we would need another $80 million. Mr. Zolli talked about building regenerative capacity, and this is more or less what we are feel that we are doing. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much. We've got maybe time for a couple of questions. Patricia, maybe one, again, coming back to the criteria for the award, one thing we're also looking for is replicability. So any messages, perhaps early mistakes, lessons that you've learned with the development of the project that might be relevant for other cities or countries looking to do something similar to your project?
I think the combination of risk management and internal controls that you need as a banker and the capacity to know exactly what people need in order to be able to enhance their capacity of payment makes this model very replicable everywhere in the world.
Mm-hmm. And one thing also from your presentation, so scale looks as though that was quite important. Do you think how you were talking about building this larger network, how important is that to make it sustainable?
Yeah, well, the important thing in Mexico, at least in the Mexican infrastructure, is that they are cooperatives with 1,000 people each cooperative, more or less. So if you go and make a relationship with the cooperative heads themselves, you can have a very high impact model very, very easily. After having developed it, it looks easy, but it's a matter, as I said before, it's a matter of financing now.
Mm-hmm. And in terms of the degree to which you've moved towards self-sufficiency with it so far, how close are you?
Well, we are already self-sufficient. We built self-sufficiency in financing terms in the first 4 months of operation. And as I told you before, the big challenge right now is to get money at very profitable levels. The return on equity for the financing part is more or less 40%. And the internal rate of return for the gas stations is 30% for the investors. Mm-hmm. And that's our main task right now.
Mm-hmm. Sounds impressive. Anybody else got any questions for Patricia? Don't think so. So, great. Well, do please, please thank her.
Thank you.
And now, Tom James. Is Tom around? Yeah, please. So Tom, director of the eco-banking department the business development partnerships at Sanergy.
Thank you very much. It's a real pleasure to be here. Thank you for having us, and good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Oh, can we go back one? Pardon me. Just getting used to it. Yeah, my name is Tom James, and on behalf of my 220 teammates in Nairobi, Kenya, it's a real pleasure to be here today talking about our work at Sanergy. Sanergy builds healthy, prosperous communities by making hygienic sanitation available and affordable to people throughout Africa's urban informal settlements. The facts on sanitation are startling. 4.1 billion people across the developing world lack access to good toilets and clean water. At Sanergy, this is a problem that we know well. We work in Kenya's informal settlements, where 8 million people lack access to hygienic toilets. I think you've missed out a slide there. Never mind. So we have a sanitation crisis across the developing world. And at Sanergy, we have developed a innovative three-part process to tackling this. We build, we collect, and we convert. First of all, we build and franchise a dense network of low-cost sanitation centers throughout the informal settlements, which we to micro-entrepreneurs who run them as viable businesses. These sanitation centers are known as Fresh Life Toilets, and unlike entrepreneurs, are known as fresh life operators. Secondly, we collect the waste on a daily basis. Our fresh life frontline team collect the waste from every single toilet, transporting it from the slums to our central processing facility. Finally, we convert the waste into usable, valuable byproducts such as organic fertilizer, which we then sell on to Kenyan farmers. But it all starts with a great product, the Fresh Life Toilet, which is built by our team of engineers. Bold, bright, and blue, they're designed to be both attractive and durable, and measuring just 3 feet by 5, can be easily installed close to homes, making them extremely accessible. All the materials are prefabricated at our factory within the community, allowing us to keep down costs while maintaining high quality. All materials are also locally sourced, whilst our assembly teams come from the communities in which we work, gaining steady income and skills development. The Fresh Life Toilet captures the waste in 2 double-sealed cartridges, making for safe and easy collection. We use a urine-diverting squat plate, which automatically separates the urine and the feces, thus reducing smell and enhancing customer satisfaction. Each toilet is good for about 100 uses per day. The communities in which we work are navigable only by narrow dirt paths. And so our Fresh Life frontline team use hand carts to ensure that they can collect the waste from each Fresh Life toilet on a daily basis, even those in the most internal areas of the slum. They are provided with full personal protection equipment and inoculations before they begin work with us. They're proud of the work that they do and are appreciated and respected within their communities because they're making a difference. Each Fresh Life operator is given a business in a box when he purchases a Fresh Life toilet. This goodie bag comes with marketing materials, a hand washing station, a uniform and cleaning supplies, enabling him to start and run a viable Fresh Life toilet business. Thanks to Kiva, an online lending platform, all of our Fresh Life operators are able to gain access to critical financial support. Fresh Life operators are eligible for 0% interest-free loans, which enable them to purchase the Fresh Life toilet. This provides them with a steady income. On a daily basis, their costs are around 30 US cents, but take into account 50 users per day, charging around 6 cents per use, our Fresh Life toilet operators can make around $1,000 per year, which is a critical supplement to household income. We opened our first toilet in the Mukuru slum of Nairobi in November 2011. Mukuru is an area of just 3 square kilometers, but home to 500,000 people. Since inception, we've opened a further 700 toilets and created around almost 700 jobs as well, including 334 Fresh Life operators. We provide access to hygienic sanitation for between 27 and 30,000 users every single day, and we have safely removed and treated 5,500 metric tons of waste. We process this waste, co-composting with other organic materials, to produce an organic fertilizer known as Evergrow, which we then sell to Kenyan farmers, who are in critical need of amendment to enable them to improve the health of their soil and so their increased crop yields and their household income. But this is just the beginning. In the next 5 years, we aim to open another 3,500 Fresh Life toilets, meeting the needs of 200,000 people every single day. We will remove from the communities 10,000 metric tons of human waste every year, and in the process, create 2,000 new jobs. Over the last 4 years, we've built a great, great network of partners, and we really couldn't work without them. We're always looking for more. So on behalf of my colleagues in Kenya and myself, I'd like to say asante sana. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Tom. Probably got, again, just a couple of minutes for questions. So there's a basic fee paid by, well, just two things, just going back on the financing. So the individual operator pays roughly how much for the to become a participant?
So a Fresh Life toilet, they would pay for around $600.
Okay. And then the individual client using the toilet pays how much?
6 cents per use, which is about the same amount. Unfortunately, they missed a slide there. But the typical sort of availability of toilets in somewhere like Makuru is something like a pit latrine or a makeshift toilet, and people are still paying to use those toilets, and they're deeply unhygienic, totally undignified, and often quite dangerous to use after dark.
Right. So is there pretty clear evidence, though, that most people are willing and do pay, or do they still, there's still quite a lot who, you know, for which even 6 cents is quite a lot, would go in other ways and avoid paying?
Well, I mean, I would say there's a critical number of people that are able to pay, and there's a culture of paying for toilets. However, clearly, if you want to reach 100% of people with sanitation and good sanitation, you're going to have to find other delivery models. And so we are looking at how we can reach people through other models, whether that is putting toilets in schools or working with landlords to put toilets in residential blocks, or trying to find some kind of subsidy or voucher system for those people who can't even afford to pay what equates to sort of 4 or 5 cents for to use a toilet. Right. So we're aware of the challenges.
And one issue in Kibera and some of the other shanty towns around the world is also security, isn't it? Particularly at night, where there's no lighting, and particularly women are reluctant to go out to use a latrine if there's a danger of being attacked. Is there any way that you can tackle that issue?
Yeah, I mean, you're absolutely right. I think people are really unwilling to go much further than sort of 50 metres from their home, and it's a real risk at night. So one of our goals is to encourage landlords to build Fresh Life toilets within residential blocks so people can safely access a toilet and sort of move away from their, you know, undignified flying toilet, as they call it.
Mm. Okay. Anyone got any questions in the audience on this? Yeah, one over there, please.
Hi, I'm Bianca from London School of Economics, a student still. So I did my undergraduate dissertation on public restrooms in Manhattan. But within that kind of research, I came across a lot of issues concerning restroom use in developing countries. And I guess a specific question I would have about this project in particular is cost-related. So if people are dealing with issues such as diarrhea there, and 6 cents is quite a bit, I know that in places like Mumbai, there's a lot of issues of paying that kind of money. So how do you deal with, how do you deal with those kinds of costs that come also with those sorts of health issues?
Do you mean how do you deal with those people that can't afford to pay, or?
Yeah.
Yes. It's something that we're trying to look at. You know, we want to reach 100% of people, and we're looking at different delivery models, whether that would be a voucher system. We also work quite closely with organisations like Oxfam and, you know, and the Kenyan government. So it's, there's a lot of people with interests in reaching these people too, and you know, not, you know, reaching people who are on a much, much tighter budget even than that. So we're certainly looking at different delivery models, and putting toilets in schools, for example, is one way, and certainly school children are not charged to use a toilet.
Okay. And Ian, one in the back there, please.
Thanks, Tom. I'm wondering how financially sustainable you've managed to make the model, particularly around the producing the fertilizer at the other end. Do you think that's going to be able to subsidize, to a certain extent, the front-end delivery of the service itself?
That's absolutely the aim, yeah. We're producing fertilizer, and we've begun to sell it. We're confident that if we can sell, once we've sold 5,000 tons, we're moving quite close towards sustainability. We're aiming to be there in the next 2 or 3 years. And certainly that will, you know, from a systems-based, you know, end-to-end sanitation model, assigning value to that waste that we're collecting will be of critical importance to sustainability.
Okay, and there's one here at the front, I think.
It's him.
Thank you, Tom. I guess this is a very interesting model you've developed here. We do similar things, and they're quite effective. Sorry, just to introduce myself again, WaterAid, Time is my name. We find this quite a challenge, really, as a model of promoting entrepreneurship and getting people to do this. So you need to develop people who naturally are entrepreneurs and who are very rugged individuals to grow through this process. But I think for this audience, something to think about, maybe the next panel will probably look at some of this issue, is that this perhaps will not be the solution to sanitation in developing countries. It will contribute largely to it, but we need bigger scale, less expensive approaches to sanitation delivery. The question will, for me, really is, how do IFC, for example, or the World Bank, through IDA, develop financing frameworks or structures that can really target sanitation in developing countries, particularly in the urban areas and secondary cities? The current model that I'm aware of is challenged by the fact that it deals mainly with national governments. And city authorities have to take approval from national governments to get those kinds of funding. We've talked about the challenges of decentralization this morning. Those are big issues that we need to grapple with. But the big funders need to think about, you know, how to support these processes of establishing sanitation at scale that can really address the issues of poor people. I can imagine if somebody earns $1.50 a day, to pay 60 cents for a pool, it's really, really
six
hard.
6 cents.
Six
not,
cents, yes.
Not 60.
For, okay, 6 cents for you and your children and your wife. I don't know. We face the same issues. It's not about synergy. In WaterAid, we face the same issue, and we thinking about how do we resolve these kinds of issues long term.
Okay. You're not the IFC, obviously.
I'm not the IFC. I think it's a really important issue. You know, Sanergy wouldn't be able to operate if the government and were already providing that service. So I think that the service we're providing is really important, but obviously it's a problem that will require all sorts of different stakeholders and all sorts of different organisations to come together and actually work out a viable, scalable solution. So it's clearly a question worth discussing in further detail.
Okay, do please thank Tom.
Thank you very much.